Hey, good evening, everybody. It's Adam Grubb, and this is Meet Me on Main, the virtual experience. Happy to have you here this evening as we go through an incredible night of discussions and interviews with those that are on Meet Me on Main, the virtual experience. And but first, before we get to any of the stars of tonight, we go out to Melanie Brewer, who is out in Carmel right now. Melanie, you've got some great stuff going on down there. What's happening where you're at?
Hi, Adam. I'm right here in front of the Mona Depot with the Historical Society, who is unveiling the sculpture by Scott Osborne right here in the Butterfly Garden. So I'm going to give it to them, and they're going to unveil this beautiful piece live with you tonight. All right, guys. Ready? We're ready.
You ready to unveil this?
Yourself and the sculpture that you've done here in the Butterfly Garden?
Yeah, I am Scott Osborne. I am a Heron graduate and have been a local Carmel artist for about 3 years now, and been loving the opportunities that they've been giving me. This right here is Beatrice the Butterfly, and followed by Crystal the Chrysalis, Carter the Caterpillar, and Eugene the Egg.
Scott, can you hear me? This is Adam.
Hey, Adam. How are you?
I'm good, sir. Hey, I wanted to ask you, this really means a lot to the community, but what does this mean to you as an artist?
Well, this has been a completely different approach to anything I've done in the community thus far. It was more of a scientific kind of challenge and trying to do a little bit of that realism that I used to do with illustration and bring it back to sculpture.
Yeah. Well, it's beautiful work, and you're going to have the easy questions. How long did this take you? What was your process, and all of that, which I'm sure we could get into at some point. But congratulations on having something here for a long, long time in Carmel, as residents the sculpture and the art in this area is known for it and continues to evolve. And you should be very proud of the work that you've done here.
Thank you very much, Adam. I appreciate that.
No problem. Scott Osborne, Melanie, thank you so much for sharing that with us. It is another sculpture in Carmel, but it is not just any sculpture. It's pretty miraculous.
Yeah, it's really beautiful. It's a nice touch for the new Butterfly Garden right outside the Monon Depot. And thank you to the Historical Society and the grant from the City of Carmel for making this happen. It's a really cool piece right here along the Monon Trail and right between Midtown and the Carmel Arts and Design District.
Yeah, it's very good. Well, thank you, Melanie. Appreciate you bringing that to us tonight as we are the virtual Meet Me on Main experience. Looks like there's some people out there, which is great. Not as many as there will be, but it looks like there's people out there watching this.
There are. There's quite a group here. They seem to love the art and Scott's piece of work.
That's right. I will pretend they weren't clapping for me. Thank you, Melanie.
Thanks. I'll see you guys soon.
All right. Thank you very much. All right. The virtual Meet Me on Main experience continues here on Carmel. We are live on Facebook and YouTube, as well as Carmel TV. We have a jam-packed hour here for you. We've got Bob's Burgers coming up here in a little bit, Evan Lurie Gallery, as well as the Lily Pie Design is going to be with us throughout the hour. But first, we kick off with the Indiana Artisan and Carrie Moncrief with us. Carrie, how are you?
I'm doing well, Adam. How are you?
I'm great. So we talked earlier in the week, and your studio and your setup is one that I think a lot of people could probably get comfortable in pretty quickly. Tell me where we're at, what you're doing, and a little bit about your work.
Well, I'm located in Newcastle, Indiana. I'm a leather worker. The name of my company is Moncrief Leathers. I'm also associated with Indiana Artisans. So you can see some of my work at the Indiana Artisan store in Carmel. So a lot of what I do, I started out making sporrans. If you don't know what a sporran is, it's something that people who wear kilts don't have pockets, so you need to have something to keep your stuff in. So that's what the sporran's for.
So let me make sure I understand this, just so I'm clear. You started your craft making something for people who wear kilts. Did you Google that before? Did anybody tell you, Gary, no one's wearing kilts anymore? Tell me about that.
Well, actually, it's not true that people aren't wearing kilts. I wear one myself.
Okay, my apologies.
But yeah, there's not as many as you might think. So, but that's why I've also branched into doing other things, such as I make ladies' purses. I make other kinds of belt bags. So you don't have to wear a kilt to enjoy a lot of what I make.
Yeah, that's very, very cool. So it's the work is painstaking. It's very difficult. It's very challenging. Or is this just a process you put into place now where you can work pretty quickly on projects?
It does take a certain amount of time. There's a lot of detail in what I do. A lot of the designs I create myself, like on this particular belt bag, I've got, there you go. This design is based on a Viking style of artwork. And so I designed the image, I transferred it to the leather. It's all hand tooled. This is all hand dyed. And then there's braiding all along the edge, front and back. That's what's called a double loop Spanish lacing. And that takes the lacing on this bag takes about somewhere between 3 to 4 hours itself just to do the lacing. So it is very time consuming, but it's something that I really enjoy doing.
Now, it appears to me as if there is a design aspect here that has to come first. You have to have an idea. You have to understand truly how those designs and patterns are going to fit onto the piece. And then there's the craftsmanship itself. And then there's the durability. So tell me about somebody, because this looks like a cool Father's Day gift, quite frankly. Father's Day coming up. This looks to be something that a dad would love to have, whether even for a golf pouch or a variety of different ways this could be used. How do you start that out with your first idea and your design and then moving that into manufacturing it?
Well, it's a lot of things. Just a lot of my work is based on things that interest me, myself. A lot of the stuff I do has a Celtic bent to it, obviously with the Celt being Scottish. So there's a lot of the work that I do has that influence on there. And that's just a matter of coming up with designs that I personally like. And I think if it's a design that I like and I execute it well, that I think other people will like it. And I've had a pretty good response with it. So as far as durability, I build these things really well. I mean, as far as I think I do anyway.
Sure.
Yeah, they're built to last. They're built like tanks. Everything is handmade by me alone. There's a lot of attention to detail in it that you don't see in a lot of work. So,
and I think that's one of those arts that's lost, that attention to detail, that hand craftsmanship, that you're making all of these yourself by hand. This is not made in a factory. This is not reproduced and shipped out the door hundreds at a time. Each one is specific and custom to the individual.
Pretty much, yes. That's very true. I don't try to repeat a lot of patterns. Every time I make one, it's a little bit different so that whenever somebody purchases one of my items, they really do have a unique item that's going to last.
Yeah, so we're with Kerry Moncrief here. He's at the Indiana Artisan. And Kerry, first of all, quick housekeeping. We are giving away gift certificates tonight throughout this show, three $100 gift cards. For anybody who's commenting on the Facebook or YouTube channels as we're broadcasting live tonight, just a comment, just let us know you're here, say hi, give us some questions, whatever the case may be throughout the hour, and then we'll pick a winner at the end of the hour tonight. Kerry, when people look at your work, what is one of the first two things they say about it? What's the feedback that you get before they even purchase it and have it? What are they saying to you just as they peruse them?
Well, kind of the first thing that people say is I never realized before I started selling my work publicly that how much people really like leather. and so that's kind of a first thing. The second of all, I think that people do comment on how well my things are made. So I do put a lot of care and attention to it. A lot of blood and sweat, as it were.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty proud of my work. I do like to sell things, and I like to make sure that when they go out the door that, you know, my customer is going to appreciate and enjoy what I make for the entire time they have it. So
well, that's great. You know, we're getting a couple comments here about the artist environment. And that's really sometimes we peel back the curtain and we get to see where things are made and the behind the scenes. It's interesting and it's very cool. As I said at the outset of this interview, is that is looks like a workman workshop and very comfortable for you. Tell me a bit about where you work, how you manufacture these, and are you always tweaking your process in some parts with your manufacturing facility, as we would call it.
My studio is in my home. It's one room, although it does spill out to other rooms too, much to my wife's chagrin at times. I like to think I'm constantly learning and I'm constantly improving on what I do. I think that you never stop learning and you can never stop being better at what you do. So I always strive to be better with each piece. And I also try to learn new techniques and try out new tools and new patterns. So it's something that I absolutely love doing. The day goes by really quickly whenever I'm at my bench making my stuff.
Well, that was my next question, Carrie, is that do you have a manufacturing process where you say, okay, today's the day I create and design. Today's the day that I build. Or are you at all times, like most creatives, whenever that creative spark hits, you go into the workshop and you get moving?
I always am thinking about what it is I'm making and what I'm going to make. And it's never really focused on just one piece at a time. I usually have three or four pieces going at once because of the process. You know, a lot of times I might cut out three or four different pieces at once, and I might dye two or three other pieces at once. And then, of course, when you're actually working on one piece, you have to focus on that piece. So, I mean, certain processes I can do more than one at a time. Other times, other parts of the process, you have to focus on that one piece.
Now, how long have you been doing this again?
I've been doing this for about 15 years.
And where?
But I've been making stuff since I was 5 years old. So, you know, actually making things is nothing new for me.
So it is not in your blood in any way. Did you have any family saying, hey, here's what I do, like a workshop, a grandfather, anything like that? Or did you just grow up thinking, hey, I want to build things, I want to make things, and over time it's turned into this?
I don't know. Making things has always been part of my life. I come from, there isn't anybody else in my family that has done leather work, but I do come from a line of craftsmen. I'm fifth generation American, and several of my great grandfathers and my great great grandfathers were woodworkers, and they actually opened up one of the first lumberyard and furniture factories in Denver, Colorado. So, you know, in a sense, I come from a line of artisans and craftsmen. So I like to think that it's in my blood, it's in my DNA.
Yeah.
But it's making stuff has always fascinated me. And when, like I say, when I was small, you know, like, both my mom and dad were always encouraging us and working with us to make stuff, you know, and you know, some of it was through like Boy Scouts and Cub Scouts, but sometimes it was just kind of a thing to do on the weekend, you know, let's go make something. So,
right.
You know, it's always been a part of me. It's really making stuff is ingrained in me, and it really is. I love doing it. I can't imagine not being able to do it.
And so Carrie Moncrief is with us here on the virtual Meet Me on Main experience, live on Facebook, YouTube, and Carmel TV. Carrie, where can people find your work, and how can they get a custom order to you? What is the process for them?
I have a website, an e-commerce site at moncriefleathers.com. I'm also on Instagram, also under moncriefleathers.com. I'm also on Facebook, and I have a YouTube channel, all under moncriefleathers.com. And so You can email me at moncriefleathers@gmail.com. So there's a lot of avenues to get to my stuff. And as I mentioned before, you can see some of my work at the Indiana Artisan store in Carmel there.
Awesome. Well, Carrie, it has been a pleasure talking to you tonight. Just fabulous work. Continued success. And as you continue to hone your craft, that's the thing about creative work and this type of work. It's never perfect. You're always trying to do something better. So congratulations, and thank you for the time tonight on the virtual Meet Me on Main experience.
Thank you, Adam. I appreciate the opportunity.
All right, good luck. Carrie Moncrief, there he goes. Thank you so much. The show continues here. We are live on Facebook, YouTube, and Carmel TV. A reminder, we have three $100 gift certificates to give away. Just comment on Facebook and or YouTube. Hello, hi, how are you? Questions, comments, anything that you have. We'll pick a winner at the end of the show. Now to one of my favorite spots, and I think many's favorite spots inside Carmel and on Main Street, is Bub's Burgers. And they are with us here, and we're right now with Matt Fry. Matt, how are you?
Good, Adam. How are you?
I'm great, sir. So this is the patio. This is the world famous, Carmel famous at the very least, Bub's Burgers and ice cream. Your restaurant is notorious for the photos, for being on Man vs. Food, but more specifically, notorious for some of the best burgers in the area. Tell me the history of Bub's Burgers.
Well, it's 17 years old, so we opened in 03, and it's just flown by. I mean, it's just crazy. Back in late of 02, we got down here over Christmas, saw the property, and it was actually for lease, and pulled in and stuck the sign under the snow and called the gentleman a bunch of times and ended up leasing that for a few years, and then we purchased it quite a few years ago. But yeah, back in 03 in May, and what a crazy 17 years it's been. It's been like 17 days or 1700 years. I mean, it's just so crazy.
Now tell me about the location, because it is prime spot. You're right there in the Monon, you're right on Main Street, and you have your patio. You've done very limited expansion. You have stayed true to kind of the roots of the restaurant, which I appreciate and love. Most people do. They don't like to see restaurants that start to become caricatures of themselves. You guys still have that very small town feel, but you make a mean burger. I'm not going to make you talk about the burgers the entire time, because I know the people will want to be hungry and then they'll flood your restaurant this evening.
That'd be horrible.
Oh yeah. Okay. Are so you're okay with that?
Flood it, please. It's 75%.
Yes, exactly. Right up to that point. Matt Fry is with us here from Bub's Burgers. Now you guys have, like I said at the beginning, you're famous for the pictures on the wall.
You're right.
Those that have not been inside your restaurant, tell us all the pictures that we see. It is a lot of people's life's mission to be on that wall, mine included. What has to happen in order to have your picture taken and put up on the wall at Bub's?
Well, the whole business plan started that we'd have this giant burger that people would walk in and kind of see the display case, kind of like the butcher shop, and be like, oh, forget about it. There's no way I'm going to eat the size of that thing. Then we had the not so ugly half pound, the settle for less quarter pound, the mini bub, thinking most everyone would eat the settle, which they do. But come to find out, so many people started eating that big ugly, which is 1 pound after cooked and the bun's a half pound, not including the cheese and roughage. So we said we'd take your picture and put it up on the wall, 4x6 picture. And so all of a sudden that north wall in Bub's with the logo on it, the wall of champions, was full of pictures within just a couple months. And that's quite a few. So about year two, people started saying, well, what do you do if I eat two? And I'm like, why would you in the first place? That's 2 pounds of meat, a pound of bread. Well, I don't know, a bigger picture. And they're like, all right. So there we went with two. And that lasted for about a year and a half. And then people were like, well, what do you do if I eat three? And I'm like, okay, there's got to be something wrong with this going on. So three big uglies, right? Pound and a half of meat, or 3 pounds of meat, pound and a half of bread. That's a poster. So it went from a 4x6 picture to an 8x11 to a poster. Then the whole man versus food thing happened, and that's when someone started eating four. So we've had two people successfully eat four, which is just insane. An hour and 45 minutes from Indonesia. Flew into IU. It was down in Bloomington. So he flew in to see his brother at IU, had lunch, came in the next day, ate four big uglies, and flew home on Sunday. I don't think you'd want to sit next to him on the plane back to Indonesia.
Not a good flight. That is not a good flight. So the man versus food is an interesting story. How did they find you? How did that even come about? And back in the day, for those of you who don't know, Man versus Food was a show on the Travel Channel. A guy by the name of Adam, ironically enough, would go around and just eat massive amounts of food. The world's biggest this, the area's biggest that. And they found you and he came in, they filmed a show there. Tell us about that story.
I still don't know how they found us. All I know is I answered the phone and the producer was like, hey, my name's Matt. I'm the producer of a show called Man versus Food. Have you ever seen it? And of course my wife, Rachel, and I were like, oh, yeah, we've seen it. And they say, well, how about if we come Monday, like May 25th? And I'm thinking, yeah, Mondays are great. It's a slower day. It's perfect. come to find out that was race weekend. So he did it. If you've seen the show, and it's still on YouTube a little bit, and if you've seen it, he's out at the track and all this kind of stuff. And then he wanted to be the first E4 Big Uglies. And the whole experience was just beyond belief, you know, and I still don't know how they found out about us. Someone had to have called. I still don't know who that is. I'd love to find out. But come to find out that they love the challenge idea. They love the ambiance, the atmosphere of the city. And then they wanted to do the four Big Uglies. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Well, worldwide, keep in mind, it was worldwide. We've had people come in for the race from all over the world. Hey, I saw you on TV and eating Big Uglies. And it's crazy.
Tell me about the names of the burgers. Where did that come from?
You know, what you would pay advertising firms thousands of dollars to do, my wife and I did over a couple Miller Lights on our couch up in Kalamazoo, Michigan, when I was working for Kellogg's at the time. And, you know, we knew we wanted to have this giant burger concept, thinking, again, that no one would really eat it. Come to find out they were. But we couldn't decide on the burger name. We already had the name Bubs. Growing up, I had the nickname Bubby, mostly from my brother-in-law, Chuck, who started the Ritz Charles, actually. So we call each other Bubby and all this stuff. But you don't go to this burger shop to eat a big, giant burger at Bubby's, right? You go to Bubs. But everyone always thinks Bubs means Big Ugly Burgers. So that's what, you know, I looked at my wife, Rachel, said, look, just Big Ugly Burgers. And then we looked at each other like, holy cow, that works, because we know what the name is.
Right.
And then the Not So Ugly and the Settle For Less Ugly and the Mini Bubs. So it just kind of happened. Wow. So very lucky.
And your food has been your biggest marketing arm, I think, to date. And your menu, the patio, your location, you guys have just an incredible spot there. And for those, and also right behind you, just over your right shoulder, is the toughest game in America and the most frustrating game. That's the ring toss.
Ring toss.
You're family friendly. You're kid friendly. It's an experience. It's not just a burger shop. It's an experience.
You got to keep in mind, I mean, there's so many restaurants out there, and there's so many burger shops, especially, right? And we put so much pride into our food. It's, you know, it's ground chuck that we hand patty every morning. It's never frozen. It's always fresh. We have our own special seasoning. Cook it however you like. We give you what we say it is on the menu, which is after cooked weight. And it's our own recipe bun that we bake every day. And hopefully we got the best staff in the world here. So, you know, there's so much that goes into it beyond just the burgers. You know, we intentionally hire a lot of young kids and teach them about salesmanship, accountability, time management, teamwork, all the things that they're going to need to know later at the next phases, because unfortunately they're not going to work at Bubs the rest of their lives. Right. They should, but they don't. So we understand that, but we want to get in their heads and teach them about that accountability factor and teach it, because it's the same thing the parents are probably saying at home. It just takes somebody else sometimes. But the result we've had over the 17 years has been phenomenal.
Yeah.
To the point where I'm getting emails from employees that have worked for us in the past, like 15 years ago, saying thanks and all this, how they finally understand it. Sometimes it hits right away. Others, it takes years. But it is what it is. We just have fun doing it and be good at it.
Well, it's pretty awesome. I have a note here that Jill Isle is going to be with us. Is she there by any chance?
Who? I'm sorry?
Jill?
Oh, Jill? Yeah, she's here. Let me turn you on her. She doesn't want to be, but she is.
She doesn't want to be. Well, look, Jill, you can't sit near the camera if you don't want to be on the camera.
I'm just tech support.
Well, tell us a bit about you, what your situation is there, and just the overall, the last couple months have been very difficult, very challenging, but you guys have made it through, and this has got to be a great weekend and a great summer that you're hoping for Bubs.
Yes. So I oversee operations and marketing here at Bubs, and I get the pleasure of working with all the kiddos, and I work very closely with Matt and Rachel here at Bubs as well. You know, the past few months have been a little difficult and had its hurdles, but Carmel has been really good to us. The community has been good to us and has supported us through it, and our staff have been amazing and stayed on board with us as well. So we are very excited about what the summer holds and the future years as well.
Now, I got a quick question. Questions coming in here from Facebook. And you, Matt, you might be able to answer this as well, but how old do you have to be to work there? Do you have job availability? How do people get involved in Bubs from a work perspective? Because I know that this summer and kids coming out of college looking for their first job, Bubs has got to be a great job for.
Yeah. And, you know, kind of fortunately, unfortunately, in this business, we're always hiring, always. And we, you know, these kids can work at the age of 14 and 15. So they're very limited on the amount of hours and what they can do and all that kind of stuff. But still, we push them out there because we want them to be scared, nervous, happy, sad, excited, all this stuff. Because again, they're going to be in those same situations later. And the sooner they're in it now, the better they'll be off later. So, and that's one of our big culture things. So, you know, we go by the culture. If we do it right and the staff is trained right and they have all those emotions and they get it, the money will come. The burgers will be sold. It's just a matter of these kids understanding that it's not as bad as they thought that it was, and it's not as hard as they thought that it was. And it's the same old story for 17 years. So we're real proud of that and how that's turned out. So it's been fun. But you can go to our website and apply online. And what was the other question there? Oh, no, what was the other question?
You know what, Matt? I don't remember. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't remember. Hey,
let me throw a question back to everybody who's watching. Last time I did this, I was cooking at on my grill. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And I cooked chicken, and I put a question out there. What temperature do you cook chicken?
145.
And there's some pretty crazy answers.
145.
Oh, my. Are you kidding, Adam? You're going to get people sick.
What are
you doing? I was going to say, whoever answers correctly first gets a free milkshake. So watch that question and answer thing and tell me who that is. But you're wrong, Adam.
Just to clarify, how what the temperature has to be to cook it or what it has to be when it's done?
When it's done.
Okay. All right.
Well, so you don't get salmonella. So you don't get sick.
I don't own a restaurant. So how would I know?
Jill is shaking her head at you.
I know. Well, I won't apply anytime soon. Okay. How's that for you? Matt Fly from Bubs Burgers and Ice Cream. Matt, thank you so much for tonight. Appreciate your time. Again, continued success. You guys are awesome. Can't wait to see you at Bubs here very, very soon.
Hey, thanks for having us. Appreciate it.
All right. Thank you very much. There he goes. Matt Fry of Bubs Burgers. Didn't realize there was going to be a quiz there for me, but here we are. This is the live virtual Meet Me On Main experience. I'm Adam Grubb, your host tonight. We are on Facebook, YouTube, and Carmel TV. Again, comments on Facebook or YouTube. And we at the end of the evening, we will pick three $100 winners for a gift card. We now move into Susan Brewer. Susan is with us, and she's at the Evan Lowry Gallery. Susan, good evening. How are you?
Hi, Adam. Good. Great.
Good. So we've had art, and then we've had food, and now we're back to art. It is a great night here on the Meet Me on Main experience. Susan, tell me a little bit about where you're at, what you do.
I'm actually one of the artists here. I've done curatorial work here for a couple of years. And then I'm kind of giving you an update of what's coming up next month. So Francisco Valverde, whose work is here, there's a lot of his work coming in from a museum in Fort Wayne. So that'll be the feature for July 2nd Saturday. Beautiful work. He's from Mexico City. As I said, I'm one of the artists. I've got some great work here myself. Some of my favorites.
Oh, yeah.
And then we also have a lot of people in the area would know Jerry Points. There's a lot of his work here. There's the encaustics that he's doing, nice bright colors, some big pieces. And it's beautiful. I wish everybody could be here. The weather is so wonderful. But hopefully next month.
It is a beautiful night. And we hope people can come there very, very soon. Now, tell me a bit about your work specifically. So, and your history in art and kind of how you approach your work.
I am an abstract expressionist. I'm at the Stutz Building downtown for 17 years. I just like the New York School of De Kooning and everyone, I just start. So it's building up layers of texture and color. There's no pre-planning. You know, it's a very impromptu, spontaneous process. And, you know, there's no formula. So all of my work is very different depending on, you know, I say, a recent piece I did, I've been doing a lot of gardening, so it has a very floral, a lot of energy in it, that type of work. So it's really about that moment in time. That's my work. But I love working big. I have some 6-foot canvases going right now. And a lot of work on paper. That's been my past few months is lots of studio time.
So that studio time is designed specifically for creative expression, or is it designed to finish a project? Where do you go?
Projects going.
Okay, so you're always doing something.
Oh, always, yes. Yeah, my studio is a hot mess. There's just stuff everywhere.
Yeah, so and some of the other artists that are there and some of the other collections, tell me a little bit about them.
We have a lot of Nick Vesey. That's the X-ray work in the back. Can we zoom on that? He does the X-ray pieces. And
so we're at the Evan Lurie Gallery here.
Our stable artist here for since the beginning of the gallery 13 years ago. Nick Beasley's work here.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's old school. It's an X-ray. You know,
yeah.
There's probably 1,000 images in here, you know, reducing, layering. It's a very complex process. As they say, nobody's knocking this guy off.
No, not at all. That is stunning work. Look at that.
That's the Rat Pack series.
So how do they find you, or how do you find these artists? What's the process, and are you always constantly evolving your gallery, moving people in and out? How does that work?
Well, Evan's carried BC and Valverde. You know, it's what he takes to his all the art shows, Art Miami, and all the big shows. But they've always been a staple of the artists here.
Great. So, and you have been there for how long?
I've been represented here since 2013, but working curatorial for 2 years now.
All right, and your day-to-day task as far as curating and working there as executive director, what does that entail? And where do you find the most enjoyment of your job and in your day?
I love promoting art. You know, people come in and they're so intimidated by art. Or people start a sentence with, you know, I don't know much about art. You know, and I love kids being, you know, exposed. There's great art here, you know. I'm afraid people have too many flat screens in their home and not enough art. that's it. It's really just, you know, meeting and greeting and meeting people where they're at, you know, and find out what they want to, if they are looking for something or just to expand their awareness about art and why people make art.
So we saw some glimpses of the gallery there. And if you don't mind, Susan, taking us around just a quick tour of some of the other pieces and some of the other areas there, because it's just a beautiful space. Even if we just kind of walk around a little bit so people can get a taste of what that experience is like there.
Yeah, this is Susan Tannen. She's local. This is the sculpture. This vessel piece. This is Robert Berkshire. He was a Heron professor. He left his estate to the school. Then we have Phil O'Malley on the far wall over here. He's a good friend of mine, local artist. Abstract as well. Another VC here hanging out, getting ready to hang.
Yeah.
Need help hanging that. Those are heavy.
Now the space there is creative. It appears to be a very modern gallery, but some of your pieces aren't just modern, correct? I mean, you've got pieces from all different types of art.
Well, it's contemporary fine art. It's definitely a contemporary focus.
Okay. And then is there any? Go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, Carrie?
No, my last question was for you, Susan, was just on the experience of coming into your gallery and people having questions, people wanting to know more about the art, wanting to know more about the history. Tell me about the staff you have there and how they help people kind of move themselves through the art world. Because as you said, it can be challenging and a little intimidating at times. And I think
another thing that we're doing a lot of here, though, as far as we have a lot, we've been doing pop-ups here, and this is Carrie Hahn, and she's been a fixture here on Second Saturdays, so it's been fun to have her here, and I'll let her kind of tell you what she's all about.
Great.
Just come to the gallery, you know, just you have to get in front of a painting and have the experience. That's what it's about.
Great. So we have the Karma Candles there. Tell us a little bit about what you've set up there at the pop-up shop.
So what I've been doing is I come in for the second Saturdays, which obviously this month I can't see you in person, but I'm hoping next month I can see you in person. And it's amazing out today. The weather's amazing. Right now I'm stationed right in front of the big human head, so which is a great place to find the gallery at. But what I do, I started making candles about 3 years ago. I make them in my home in Carmel, Indiana. And my degree was in art therapy. So I actually, this week has been a really awesome week. I am happy to say I'm a 4-year cancer survivor. So I celebrated that this week.
Congratulations.
My treatment, just making candles was really therapeutic for me. So I use soy wax, cotton wicks, everything's clean, natural ingredients. But I have lots of fun stuff that I do. So I have my standard candles that I pour. And then one of the things that I'm known for is I use a lot of luxury glass. So like these are, this is a cloche candle. So just really cool glass that I use. And then with quarantine, people not being able to get out of their homes, one of the things I started doing was an at-home, make your own soy candle at home kit.
That's great.
So one of the most fun things I've done is I pour in vintage glass too. So this is a vintage hen that I made into a candle. But I actually, today I premiered my my man candle, which, so this is a ammo can. And I've made it into a candle. So it's my mandel. And it's 3 pounds of wax. So, and it's been, it, I was at the Noblesville Farmers Market today, and I sold out of them. So hugely popular for Father's Day.
Well, that is great. Congratulations first on the cancer surviving. That's unbelievable. And it's so great that you were able to utilize something that you already love to help you get through that. And now you're sharing that with residents and the community. It's wonderful. And it's art, it's candle, it's therapeutic. It's your work. It's handcrafted. It's really, really awesome. So congratulations. Yeah. Thank you for sharing.
One of the things I do, I work with a lot of foundations too, even local foundations. So like I'll do a candle for a cause. So I have a candle right now with Prevail out of Noblesville, and I give back a percentage of sales.
Right.
So that's something that I really like to do too, is get involved with the community and give back. So.
Well, thank you so much for sharing it with us tonight here on the Carmel Virtual Meet Me on Main Experience. Susan, thank you as well to you.
Thank you.
We appreciate you taking us through the gallery. And we'll see you very, very soon in person, okay? All right, peace, Susan. Thank you so much. There she goes. Susan Brewer was with us here as we are on the Carmel Meet Me on Main virtual experience. We're moving right now to Lily Pie and the Lily Pie design. Lily, how are you? Good evening. I think you're muted. Yep, I know. Live, it's okay. Don't worry.
I'm not a panic.
It's okay.
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. So, We talked earlier about people's looking inside their studio and in their workspace and that kind of behind the scenes. It appears as if that's what's happening here. Tell us a little about you and where you're at and kind of what you do.
So I have lived in Carmel for 14 years, and I'm an architect by profession. I started jewelry as a way to make friends when I moved to Indianapolis, or rather Carmel, and I've been taking classes at the Indianapolis Art Center. That's where my journey with creating jewelry began, and I have just absolutely found it a great therapy these years, and especially during this tough time.
Sure.
During quarantine, it's been a blessing.
You know what?
Come down and get on with some therapeutic, jewelry.
So that's what is really cool about Carmel Main Street, about the Arts and Design District, is just the different types of art and craftsmanship that we've seen last month and this month from all of the different artists, from leather to candles to works of art on the wall, now to jewelry. Where did that love and passion for jewelry come from? And your process has got to be pretty specific, I would assume.
It is. So I basically I work with silver, mainly with silver. I do use copper and gold as well. It gets expensive with gold. I use that, and I have my studio, as you can see. That's my workbench right at the back, and I have acetylene torch just next to my laptop. And I use, I use it to make. So, like I said, I'm an architect by profession, so I call this my micro architecture. So these, this is a pair of earrings, and what I like to do is craft it into little 3D pieces. So I do that, and also during the quarantine, I've been, knitting with metal. So I've been doing this little guy here, and this is with gold. So it keeps me busy for a bit.
I
have a finished piece of bracelet here.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Thank you.
So do you have somebody in mind when you are making these? Do you have a look and a feel and an emotion of somebody who would wear your jewelry, or are you making something that you feel is showcasing either the best work or the best raw materials? What's the thought process behind those pieces?
So what I like to do is I really believe in wearing, you know, your lifestyle. So I like to create timeless, elegant pieces, Adam, and just to, you know, so women can just put it on. They don't have to think about it. They're made with hardy material, so they can just wear it all day long, wear it every day, and just kind of enjoy my piece of art. And I like to say, I really want to empower women when they wear my jewelry. So I do have, for some of my pieces, for most of them, on pendants especially, bigger pieces, I do have a little stamp, and I usually put in a word like, you know, I put things like happy and love and, you know, be still. So people know that, you know, it helps to be mindful and just kind of wear it with pride, really. I like to just empower women that way.
Yeah, and that's what I think is really cool, is that you are thinking about that person and their feelings and their thoughts and how to help them not just appear better and look better, but feel better and feel empowered or feel safe or feel comfortable or calm. Those are the things that you don't get with a high manufactured rate in jewelry. This is handcrafted. This is designed by you. This is local. Lily Pie is with us here, Lily Pie Designs. Do you do any custom pieces where someone says, hey, I've had a death, or I've had a birth, or I've had an anniversary, I've had some monumental thing in my life that I want to commemorate with a piece of jewelry? How does that work for you? And do you enjoy that type of work?
Absolutely, I do. And I should tell you a story. A couple of years ago, I was approached through the Indiana Artisan website. A gentleman found me and wanted me to design a pendant for his wife, and they had such a neat story. So she was very close to her grandfather, and he lived down in Tennessee, and he was I believe it was the Curahee Mountains. I might have not pronounced it right, but so he was used to go up and down the trail, and his granddaughter made that trail 3 years ago, and she wanted me to give her a pendant that had, you know, some identification to that incident. And I was really happy I could give her that custom piece. And I'm sure she wears it with pride now. She was thrilled with the result. And again, I had inscribed the mountain at the back, and I had a modern design, but it kind of, for her, it had a lot of meaning. So when she sees it, she knows what it means. And, I thought it was a neat way to celebrate your memories and your grandfather.
Absolutely. And, you know, that brings up that other point of the longevity of your jewelry and the stories behind it and passing down generations, and a mom giving to a daughter, or a grandmother giving to a granddaughter. There's so many of those moments, I'm sure, that you never get to see, and you never get to fully understand how much they love that piece that you worked tirelessly on and put together for them. Do you wish that you could see those moments, or is it good enough knowing that that happens?
I think, honestly, I would love to see those moments. I love to connect with people, but I think it gives me a sense of satisfaction knowing that, you know, the end result goes to the person. And even if I'm not personally there to witness it, I think it's nice to just see them, you know, to connect and know that it's happened, to know that those moments count and people really take pride, especially giving gifts to their moms. I've done custom jewelry for a mother with three daughters, and, you know, just, but it's always modern design. So that's how I brand myself. But it's all these moments that where you connect with other people in a meaningful way is what gives me the greatest joy.
And it's not just jewelry. It's not just something you put on for a night out. It has a story. It has a meaning. It has an impact. And Lily, it's miraculous and unbelievable work that you're doing. And we're very, very proud to have you on tonight to showcase the residents of Carmel and the surrounding areas. You are at the CCA Gallery, Indiana Artisan, Lily Pie Designs. Lily, thank you very, very much for being on tonight.
Thank you, Adam. Thanks. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
All right. Enjoy the rest of the weekend. Lily Pie and Lily Pie Designs are here on the virtual. Thank you very much. This is the Carmel virtual Meet Me on Main experience at the Carmel Arts and Design District, live on Facebook, YouTube, and Carmel TV. We bring back in now Melanie Brewer, who is still out and about. Melanie, you're getting the good assignment tonight. You're out in Carmel. I'm here in the studio. But tell me, the evening has been great and just some fascinating stories.
Yes, it's been really fun hopping around and watching all this go down virtually. And I can't wait till you're here with me next time, Adam, in the Arts and Design District, so you don't miss out on any of the excitement. But I can tell you what, I've already got my shopping list from visiting all these places tonight with my mask.
Yes, obviously. That's why I'm here. I didn't want to wear the mask. All the people that we've talked to tonight, and we've had a lot of comments, had a lot of viewers, but we do have prizes. That's what's great about this.
Not only
to show all the stories, all the people behind the art and behind the craftsmanship, but people win stuff too. That's a victory for everybody. Three $100 gift cards were given away tonight.
Yes. So I can tell you where those gift cards are from. Kerr Spall, which is right here on Main Street in the Carmel Arts and Design District, $100 there. And Metal Mark, which is a beautiful jewelry store with some local handcrafted items that you can choose from, $100 there. And then also, I'm going to grab a $100 gift card from Anthony's Chop House. So, who's going to be our winners tonight?
So, is that on me to do that?
No, actually, Carolyn's going to pick them, and we might just have to announce them since we were out here on Main Street working and holding the cameras. You guys got to stay tuned. We're going to announce it on the page tonight when we get offline.
Great. That sounds great. You had me nervous there. I thought I missed an assignment.
No, Adam, you've done great.
Well, thank you very much for bringing all the artists together so we could showcase the residents of Carmel. And I think next month we're going to be doing this live again. And hopefully right there live with you on Main Street as we go through more artists. It's really great. So meet me on Main, the virtual experience. Melanie, thank you so much for allowing us to bring this to Carmel live on Facebook, Carmel TV, and YouTube. We'll see you next month. I'm Adam Grubb. Have a great evening, and thanks for watching.
Good.